So good morning, everyone. Today we are going to talk about an interesting topic of behavioral biases and with its real life examples. I and Ritu will be presenting on this types of behavioral biases. So introduction. These are cognitive shortcuts and tendencies that our brains use to simplify decision making. While often useful, they can also lead us to a clue. Let's explore some of the definitions and how they affect our everyday decisions. Confirmation bias. The tendency to search for, interpret, and remember information that confirms our pre-existing beliefs. Let's talk about confirmation bias. This leads us to favor information that aligns with our existing beliefs and to disregard or undervalue information that contradicts them. Like having a tunnel vision where we only see what we want to see. For example, someone who believes in a specific diet will pay more attention to articles supporting it and overlook evidence that suggests otherwise. Second is hindsight bias, the tendency to see events as having been predictable after they have already occurred. Hindsight bias occurs when people believe after an event has happened that they knew it was going to happen all along. For example, after a company's success, investors might say they always knew it would succeed, even though they might not have been so confident before the success. Anchoring bias. The tendency to rely too heavily on the first piece of information encountered when making decisions. This occurs when we give an undue weight to the first piece of information we receive. For example, if the first price you see for a car is 20,000, it sets a benchmark in your mind and all subsequent prices are judged relative to that anchor. This can change how we see what makes a good deal. Next is overconfidence bias. This is a tendency to overestimate one's own abilities, such as accuracy of knowledge or decision-making skills. It happens when individuals overestimate their own abilities or the accuracy of their predictions. For example, a person might believe they are an excellent driver despite having had several accidents, or a trader might take risky investments believing they can predict the market better than they actually can. Availability heuristic. This tendency to overestimate the likelihood of events based on their availability in memory, particularly recent or vivid memory. This bias occurs when we overestimate the importance or likelihood of events based on how easily they come to mind. For example, after watching news reports about airplane crashes, people overestimate the danger of flying, even though it's statistically much safer than driving. This happens when the dramatic events are more memorable than thus seem more common than they actually are. Next is recency bias. The tendency to weigh recent events more heavily than early events. It happens when we give more importance to the most recent information over older information. For instance, an investor might decide to buy a stock because it has performed well in the last few weeks, ignoring its long-term performance. Next is loss aversion. The tendency to prefer avoid losses rather than acquiring equivalent gains. The pain of losing is psychologically about twice as powerful as the pleasure of gaining. Next is self-serving bias. Self-serving bias is the tendency to attribute positive events to one's own character, but attribute negative events to external factors. For example, if a student does well on a test, they might say it's because they are smart, but if they do poorly, they might blame the test as being unfair. From here, Ritu will be taking on impact.
Thank you, Shweta. So now let's discuss on some of the impacts that we have of behavioral biases in our daily life. First, let's talk about the confirmation bias. So as we all know, it is the tendency to search for and remember information that confirms one's preconceptions that one has already holded. So one example can be only reading the news articles that are aligning with their own political beliefs. So one impact that, you know, it can have on your daily life includes limiting your exposure to diverse viewpoints and reinforcing those existing beliefs. So you are not open to different perspectives, and your thought and your beliefs become narrow day by day. So that is what confirmation bias has an impact. The next one, if we take the example of anchoring bias, that is relying heavily on the first piece of information that you have encountered while making decision. So it can lead to you making poor financial decisions, and because you have made judgments that are skewed by the anchor, that is, it has been skewed by the first piece of information that you have come across. So it can lead to a lot of loss in the financial sector by an individual, because you're influenced by the initial price that was offered during the negotiations. The next impact can be skewed risk assessment and potentially irrational behavior. So this is mostly observed in the availability heuristic. So when you overestimate the importance of information that is most readily available, so one piece of information that you have readily available to you, you only focus on that instead of, you know, taking into all the other kinds of information which you might have to search for more or work upon more. So you overestimate that a plane crash might occur because you have just heard about a recent incident, but you do not actually observe the statistics of how rare that is in nature, or how few flights, you know, they encounter a plane crash. So it can lead to skewed risk assessment about a risk that might not actually be there. The next impact can be, it can lead to risky behaviors and potential losses. So what this actually means is when you are overestimating your own ability or your own accuracy of your knowledge. So you overestimate yourself, you become overconfident with your own abilities, and you become overconfident about the type of knowledge that you hold. So it can impact in all the various aspects of your day-to-day life. It includes, but one most common example can be in the financial sector. So you become very overconfident in your ability to predict the stock market movements, and it can lead to you making very risky behavior, and it can lead to you facing or coming across a lot of loss in that sector. We can also say that, you know, it can result in bubble formation and subsequent crashes in the financial sector as well. So when you follow the actions of a larger group, not just in the financial sector, but when you talk about even in the social, as a social influence, when you just go ahead with the actions of a larger group, often irrationally, and you do not think about what you actually want to do or whether what everyone is doing is the right way to go about. So you just do what everyone else is doing, and if it is not right, because it's not always that if everyone is doing it, it is going to be the right thing to do. So it can lead to a lot of issues for you if you just, you know, don't use your brain and just follow the actions of the larger group. Another impact that we can talk about can also be when we talk about loss aversion. So it is the tendency to prefer avoiding losses rather than acquiring equivalent gains. So you avoid losses, but so you are not focusing on how to gain something, but you are focusing on how to avoid a loss. And in that manner, it can lead to you not growing as such, because you will just stay in that particular place that you are. You will not be actually working towards your growth, but just, you know, not going down as well, but not moving forward. So it can be observed in your business strategies as well. If a person has invested in some business and he's just trying to get defensive, he's just trying to, you know, avoid all the wrong things to do, avoid all the losses, but he's not working towards how to make that business grow. So the business is not going to grow, and it is going to stay in the same place that it previously was. One example that we can take for this can be that, you know, if you observe a mother who is highly concerned about the safety of her children and she has been following news stories about some reactions about the childhood vaccinations that people are taking nowadays. So although these cases are statistically very rare, they have been covered extensively in the media. So because these dramatic stories are fresh in her mind and she can easily recall these memories, she begins to overestimate the likelihood of her own children experiencing a severe reaction to vaccines. So the vivid and frequent media coverage makes these rare events seem more common and probable than they actually are. So how is this going to impact her? She will decide to delay or skip her children's vaccinations because she believes that taking them is going to be riskier than not taking them, because she's unaware of the actual statistics of the vaccinations and their impact. Also, she might experience heightened anxiety and stress over her children's health and safety, which is going to affect her overall well-being. Also, by not vaccinating her children on schedule, she's going to increase their risk of contracting preventable diseases, and which can lead to a lot of serious health consequences. So what can we do to avoid this type of behavioral bias that she's going through? The first thing that you can do is consult with health professionals, so she can discuss the concerns that she has with a trusted pediatrician who can provide accurate information about the risk that the vaccinations actually hold. She can use reputable sources like WHO and other such available sources who provide you with information on vaccination safety and statistics. So use those sources, educate on the probabilities. So learn about the actual statistical probabilities of severe reactions. So in this, we observed that she was facing availability heuristic. And these are some of the strategies. Now, moving forward with some of the strategies that you can use to mitigate these biases. So we'll be covering some of the strategies to counteract these behavioral biases. So when we talk about decision-making frameworks, so it includes implementing systematic approaches to decision-making. So you make a system or you implement that systematic approach to make a certain decision without being affected by that bias that you're actually holding. So weighing the benefits and the drawbacks of the options, mapping out the possible outcomes and their probabilities that, you know, that are present. It is going to reduce the reliance on intuition, and it is going to anchor the decisions using logic and proper data. The next is using checklists. So using them to ensure all relevant factors are considered. So you are considering all the factors and not just focusing on one particular perspective that you have already come across. So you're ensuring that all aspects of that potential decision are evaluated, and then you are making a decision. What this will do is it will minimize the oversight, and it ensures a thorough evaluation of the situation, the context, so that you are able to make a better decision. The next is cognitive debiasing techniques. So it usually involves bringing in awareness and educating the person. So educating them about the common biases that are present and what impact it has on a person. Teaching them about biases and how to recognize them, increasing self-awareness and reducing the susceptibility to those biases. It also includes pre-mortem analysis. So imagining that a decision has failed and working backward to identify the potential flaws, identifying the potential risks and mitigating them in advance. So you already identify what risk the decision or the situation can hold, and you try to, you know, find a solution for that in advance. So this is going to highlight the potential problems, and it is going to encourage you being proactive with your problem solving. The next is red teaming. So it includes assigning a team to challenge the assumptions and identify what the weakness is are present in the plan that you want to implement. it includes having a separate team. So you form a team for this specifically to critically evaluate a strategy before implementation. So it is going to expose all the blind spots that people have ignored or have not come across until now. They were not aware of that. And it is going to promote robust decision making. The next one, last but not the least, is awareness raising initiatives. So it includes bias training and workshops. So conducting sessions to educate on biases and their effects, role playing and case studies to illustrate those biases, So it is going to increase the awareness and equip the individuals with tools to recognize and mitigate those biases. Then we talk about feedback loops. So it includes establishing mechanisms for regular feedback on decisions and behaviors, collecting feedback from peers, subordinates. And what this is going to do is it will provide you with a diverse perspective and highlight the main areas that you require improvement in. And the last point here can be diverse teams. So building teams with diverse backgrounds so that the decision quality will be incorporated by a varied perspective. So not just if one is being biased to a certain, you know, if they are they are unaware of the bias that they have for themselves, having a different perspective, because there are a lot of people there who have various perspectives of their own, so they can give their input, and it is going to reduce the groupthink that is going to be present in the team. So that's it for strategies to mitigate these biases. Moving forward to Shweta, can you please change the slide? Thank you. So conclusion, what we talked about in this whole presentation. Behavioral biases are systematic deviations from rationality, which affect the judgments and decisions of an individual. We discussed some key biases, which included confirmation bias, hindsight bias, overconfidence bias, availability heuristic, anchoring bias, recency bias, self-serving, and loss aversion. We also highlighted how these biases can lead to suboptimal decisions and irrational behaviors. And there were some practical strategies which were suggested to counteract biases, such as the devil's advocate approach and reliance on statistical data and expert advice. So now let's move forward with the quiz. The first question is, which of the following is confirmation bias? Option A is the tendency to seek out information that contradicts one's beliefs, the tendency to seek out information that supports one's beliefs, the tendency to overestimate the likelihood of events based on their availability in memory, or option D, the tendency to undervalue possessions simply because they are owned by oneself. Correct. The right answer is option B, the tendency to seek out information that supports one's beliefs. Moving forward to the second question, which of the following is an example of the availability heuristic? Believing a stock is a good investment because a friend recommended it. Option B, overestimating the likelihood of shark attacks after watching several news reports about them. Option C, valuing a car more highly because you own it. Option D, buying a house without negotiating because the asking price was the first price mentioned. Yes. The correct answer is option B, overestimating the likelihood of shark attacks after watching several news reports about them. Moving forward. Shweta, can you change the slide, please? What strategy can help mitigate the impact of confirmation bias in decision making? Option A, relying solely on intuition. Option B, consulting a single source of information. Option C, adopting a devil's advocate approach to consider opposing viewpoints. Option D, following the majority opinion. Right. The correct answer is option C, adopting a devil's advocate approach to consider opposing viewpoints. The next question is, how can the availability heuristic affect health-related decisions? Option A, by making one undervalue the risk of common diseases. Option B, by leading one to disregard vivid but rare health risks. Option C, by causing one to overestimate the likelihood of rare but dramatic health events. And option D, by ensuring a balanced viewpoint of health risks and benefits. Yes, the correct answer is C, by causing one to overestimate the likelihood of rare but dramatic health events. Thank you so much, everyone, for your inputs. If you have any questions, kindly feel free.